Today, we're talking about a method that's so common, it's often overlooked. I'm talking about using cold water or even ice water to make your bread and pizza doughs. Now, I want to make it clear, this is not a video about cold fermentation. While it sounds similar, this is a completely different method with its own unique benefits. In most recipes, the simple act of using cold water isn't even given a name. It's just treated as a boring first step before the dough goes in the fridge for cold fermentation. But what if I told you this small, seemingly unremarkable step could make your bread fluffier and dramatically improve its texture? And what if I showed you that a 200-year-old French baking book already figured this out, and now we've got modern science to back it up? In this video, we're taking this method out of the shadow of cold fermentation. We're going to talk about the science of why it works and how we can best apply it to our bread and pizza doughs as home bakers. Let's get into it. Hey, Seraphine here. Welcome back to the channel. In the comments of our channel, I get a lot of feedback. Some of you ask great questions like why I use a technique like bassinage in one video but not another, or why some recipes have eggs and others don't. And then I get the critiques. And you know what? Every single one of these comments reminds me of my former self when I first started baking. Because back then, I saw a recipe as a rule book. It was a set of precise instructions that you followed perfectly or you failed. As a beginner, I was bound by these rules. I wouldn't substitute anything or change the timing, let alone the method. I was more like a robot following instructions rather than a home baker trying to learn. That all changed when I started learning the science behind the recipe. Suddenly, a recipe became a foundation to build upon, not a cage to be locked in. And I found that to turn a good recipe into an amazing final product, you have to understand how the ingredients and methods work together. That is what we're doing for this simple method of using ice or cold water to make our doughs. This little step doesn't really have a name, unlike bassinage or autolyse, but it is surrounded by quite a bit of confusion. Many home bakers feel bound by recipe rules and therefore don't understand the purpose of this method. In fact, if you look up using cold or ice water online, you'll find two main arguments. The first is something called desired dough temperature. This is when bakers use cold or warm water to achieve a specific temperature. The rationale goes, if it's a hot day, you add cold water to slow the yeast down. If it's a cold day, you add warm water to speed it up. It's all about creating a consistent environment for the yeast. The second argument for using cold water, you'll find, is usually tied to cold fermentation. Bakers use ice water to get the dough cold before it goes into the fridge, arguing that a slower fermentation gives you better flavor. So, again, it's all about the yeast. But the problem with these two major opinions is that they're both missing a crucial fact. Adding ice water to your dough isn't just about the yeast. Some of the biggest benefits are found in the dough's structure. And what's shocking is how a book from over 200 years ago proves more trustworthy on this than many online resources today. As it turns out, if you've ever used cold water to make your dough, you have an unlikely ally in a man who lived over 200 years ago. His name was Antoine Parmentier. While he's most famous for popularizing the potato in France, he was also a pharmacist. And surprisingly, he wrote a book on bread called The Perfect Baker, published in 1778. In this book, Parmentier took a firm stand against what he called a fatal habit of many bakers, using the hottest water that they could get. He believed this was a terrible mistake and scathingly wrote that they must attribute the defects that are rightly reproached in their bread to this very practice. He said they could spare themselves these embarrassments by using the coldest water possible. Finding this felt incredible. Long before modern science, Parmentier understood something many miss today. He wrote that cold water affected the dough's glutinous material, giving it firmness and elasticity. 200 years later, we call that glutinous material gluten, and we know that he was absolutely right. The temperature of your dough doesn't just affect the yeast, it fundamentally impacts the gluten, the very structure that allows your bread to rise. Modern science confirms this. A 2003 study showed that making dough at lower temperatures resulted in better bread with improved texture and volume. Another study using carbon dioxide snow to lower mixing temperatures also saw improved bread volume. Furthermore, a recent paper found that combining low-temperature water with high-temperature flour resulted in a greater degree of gluten aggregation after 9 minutes of mixing. So, why does all this happen? Well, let's do a quick rundown of how gluten works. About 80% of the protein in your flour is gluten protein. When we knead our dough or mix it in a stand mixer, what we're trying to do is form a 3D network of gluten proteins inside your bread dough. You can sort of think of these proteins as individual strands in the network, and they link together or to other components of the dough with a bunch of different bonds. At the end of kneading or mixing, this network will spread throughout the dough. That way, it can trap all the gas that the yeast produces and hold the dough together. Here's where temperature comes in. Mixing dough at a lower temperature appears to strengthen and multiply its hydrogen bonds. While these bonds are weaker than other bonds individually, their immense quantity creates a powerful cumulative effect, making the whole structure stronger. Low-temperature mixing also promotes the formation of stable macromolecular aggregates of gluten, basically strong clumps of gluten that don't break down easily. On the other hand, higher temperatures can lead to irreversible protein denaturation. This is a big reason why overmixing in a stand mixer is a problem. Mixers generate a lot of heat. Doughs also tend to become sticky and less stable when the temperature exceeds 27 degrees Celsius. One study even found that mixing at 16 degrees Celsius can increase dough elasticity by 21%. The result is a firmer, more stable dough that can hold more gas, leading to better volume. Okay, enough theory. How do we turn this into practical information for our kitchens? There are a couple of key things to remember. First, you might be able to add more water. Studies found that colder doughs have a higher optimal water absorption. Practically, this means you can probably get away with adding a little more water to your cold dough. This helps it reach a higher consistency, giving you a firmer dough that could rise even more. Second, you should mix or knead the dough for longer. A lower dough temperature generally requires a longer mixing or development time to build that strong gluten network. So take a little longer to mix or knead your cold dough. Sometimes you might not be able to rely on a timer. You may have to rely on the feel of the dough and, of course, the window pane test. And a note on flour, one study found that at lower mixing temperatures, doughs made with soft wheat flour started to act like dough made from hard wheat flour. This links right back to Parmentier, who noted that even the softest doughs can be made firm with cold water. So if you use softer flours, this method could have an even bigger impact for you. Now, although I didn't find studies specifically on ice water for pizza dough, the same logic applies. A stronger gluten network would likely make the pizza dough stronger and more extensible. It might take a little longer to stretch, but the payoff should be worth it. High hydration pizza doughs would probably benefit the most as the cold water improves firmness and makes them easier to handle. You could also see a bit more airiness in your crust. This is actually something I've been using in my recent pizza attempts, and the texture was truly delightful. Recipe coming soon. Okay, at this point, if you're interested in the really technical side of things, I want to bring up one fascinating paper. Researchers studied doughs that all ended up at the same final temperature, but they changed the starting temperature of the flour and water. They tested cold water and hot flour, hot water and cold flour, and room temperature water and room temperature flour. What they found was pretty wild. After just 3 minutes of mixing, the hot water and cold flour method actually produced a stronger, smoother dough. I have to wonder if this is the trap these 18th century bakers fell into. They saw quick results and thought it was better. However, when the doughs were properly mixed for around 9 minutes, the results completely flipped. The cold water and hotter flour method was superior. It created the strongest, most uniform, and continuous gluten network. Why? It seems that cold water allows for a more gradual and even hydration of the gluten proteins, exposing more sites for strong bonds to form over a longer mixing time. Now, this study was on noodles, so take the timings with a grain of salt. The key takeaway for us is that giving your cold water dough enough time to mix and develop is absolutely crucial to getting the best results. So the big lesson here is that using cold water is about much more than just controlling your yeast. It's a powerful tool for building a superior gluten structure, leading to better bread and pizza. It is, however, crucial to remember to give it a little more mixing time and maybe even a splash more water. It's also probably a good idea to aim for a significant temperature difference between your flour and water, trying to make sure the water is a lot colder than the flour. And naturally, this technique works beautifully with cold fermentation. As I mentioned in my video on that topic, combining lower mixing temperatures with a long cold ferment is a fantastic way to achieve both superior flavor and superior volume in bread. If you're worried about the time, then you can use a bit more yeast to speed up the cold ferment, doing a quick cold ferment. I explained that full technique in that video, so be sure to check it out. And that's it for this video. I hope this shed some light on a simple but powerful technique. Let me know in the comments if you already use cold water in your doughs. Thanks for watching, and bye!